Hello everyone and welcome back to Very Cold Lasagna. I am your filthy casual host with all the filthy casual takes, Dylan Lasagna. And we got another week of NFL football coming your way. And it's another week of filthy casual picks here on this show. And, well, week three was total shit. It was total butt cheeks with all the ugly play that happened. And, well, hopefully this week will provide some more exciting action, more cleaner football as we reach the quarter point of the season. But unfortunately, week four didn't exactly get off to the most exciting of starts, and it kind of went on a big sour note. And that started off on Thursday Night Football only on Amazon Prime Video as the Cincinnati Bengals beat the previously unbeaten Miami Dolphins 27-15, mainly in part due to the Bengals offense, finding their identity once again on offense with the involvement of Jamar Chase, Tyler Boyd, T. Higgins, that offensive line gelling together, protecting Joe Burrow for the most part, and getting that big win to even themselves at 2-2. Heading into their big week five matchup against the Baltimore Ravens, getting that extra day of rest. But that biggest story in that Thursday night is, of course, the health of Tua Tagovailoa after he took another scary hit. It's the second one in just 4 days from that Sunday to Thursday stretch in that second quarter. And he had to be stretchered off and taken to a hospital. Very unfortunate situation, very scary situation for him. I was literally clutching his fingers, just frozen there. It was very scary. It was very a scary situation for him. He was like a very severe concussion. I was very surprised that they discharged him. But I mean, it was great news that he had movement in his body, but if I'm Tua, I would not step in that organization. I would stay away from them for a while until this investigation from the NFL Players Association reaches a conclusion that the Dolphins lied about what their prognosis was to let Tua back in that game this past Sunday against the Bills. And I don't know. It's just, in my opinion, it's just worrisome. For Tua right now. It is very worrisome. It's concerning for Tua's health right now. Two concussions, what seems like, in the multiple days. So, hopefully, Tua, prayers up for him. He gets well. And hopefully, all the best for him in these next couple of days and in the future. Going to the Sunday slate of games, in the early morning at early ass o'clock at 6 a.m. Pacific time, which I'm probably not going to wake up for, even though I have work on Sunday. The Minnesota Vikings and the New Orleans Saints battle in London, and they need a critical win as well. From last week's results, the Minnesota Vikings rallied back from two different deficits to beat the Lions, but the Saints, where it matters, they struggled offensively in a loss to the Panthers. So, for both of these teams, for the Vikings, how can Kirk Cousins end this offense? How can they take advantage of what's been a pretty vulnerable Saints defense? They didn't really look that good against the Panthers. Meanwhile, for the Saints, at some point, it's not that James Winston has been bad, but you have to wonder because he's not exactly been healthy. Hence why it's been affecting his play. At some point, do you see Andy Dolan replace James Winston for health reasons? And because of the defense that's there in Minnesota, and because despite the inconsistent play of Kirk Cousins, I still think that the Vikings are going to win this game just because of how, not only inconsistent, but less than 100% James Winston is at the moment. So I'm going to roll with the Vikings on this one. Next up, we have the Cleveland Browns going to Atlanta to take on the Falcons. The Browns, in their Week 3 game, made fewer mistakes than the Steelers to net a 29-17 win, whereas the Falcons, they got a solid day out of Cordell Patterson, Kyle Pitts, and even Marcus Mariota to get them their first win of the season over the Seahawks. The biggest story for the Falcons is, their ability to protect Marcus Mariota against a Brown defensive line that could potentially be without Myles Garrett, who was involved in a car accident this past week. You know, hopefully he does well. And apparently it's only minor injuries, but you know, you want to be fully recovered, and hopefully Myles Garrett's okay. As for the Browns, you know, this could potentially be a Nick Chubb and Kareem Hunt game again, especially considering that the Falcons' run defense is not that great. So I'm going with the Cleveland Browns in this one, but hey, any given Sunday. And in the big matchup on Sunday, the Buffalo Bills take on the Baltimore Ravens. For the Bills, well, they're looking to bounce back from what was a missed opportunity for them on Sunday, because they were held out of the end zone for much of the game, and they failed to come in clutch in the loss to the Miami Dolphins. Meanwhile, Lamar Jackson continued to look like a man on a mission and gassing the New England Patriots 37-26. So for the Bills, you know, they're getting some of their key players back on defense after they missed the Dolphins game. For the Ravens, while their defense remains a bit of a concern, their offense, you know, is more than making up for it. So while I do pick the Baltimore Ravens to win this game, you know, just keep an eye out for that Bills offense to fire back. I do think this is going to be a shootout that Baltimore may win. The Washington Commanders traveled to Jerry's World to take on the Cowboys. Last week, it was 9 sacks. That was the lucky number for the Commanders and Carson Wentz because, well, they basically got nothing going in their loss to the Philadelphia Eagles. Carson Wentz's old team, while the Dallas Cowboys felt the rush. They felt the rush in Cooper again in a Monday night win over the New York Giants. So I'm picking the Dallas Cowboys to win this game because the Commanders just don't look like they have anything going on offense, especially with the offensive line. They cannot protect Carson Wentz. And even then, Carson Wentz is still making the same mistakes over and over again. And for the Dallas Cowboys, Cooper Rush is, you know, manning the four okay. You know, Dak Prescott seems like he's going to be coming back early. But, you know, I think Cooper Rush can manage this game one more time. Next up, we have the Seattle Seahawks traveling to Detroit to take on the Lions. The Seahawks, you know, they were battling in a shootout for what could be for the number one overall pick in next year's draft against the Falcons, but they just couldn't do enough to outlast the Falcons in a potential shootout. But hey, they're doing themselves a favor as they lost to the Falcons in that game. As for the Lions, you know, they look like what could be a dynamic offense in the future. They had two separate big leads over the Minnesota Vikings, but they just couldn't hang on to it. Their play calling was kind of odd, and they eventually lost the lead for good, and they tried to get it back, but an interception by Jared Goff sealed their fate against Minnesota. So for the Detroit Lions, they got to learn how to close out games that they're leading. That starts against the Seahawks. And for the Seahawks, they gotta slowly find a way to overcome their mistakes, if that's even possible. So I'm gonna pick the Detroit Lions. The LA Chargers traveled to Houston to take on the Texans in a rematch from last year's Week 16 upset of the Texans. So the injury bug for the Clippers is hitting big time at a very bad time. It's happening early, folks. The Clippering is happening as they got beat down by the all-elite Jacksonville Jaguars. Yes, Tony Conman's AEW Jaguars dominated the Clippers 38-10 in their home turf. Yikes. Big yikes. Meanwhile, for the Texans at Davis Mills, I mean, they were no better. They were playing a whole bunch of Bears football, John, in a 20-23 loss to the Chicago Bears. For the Chargers, I mean, they got to find a way to get healthy, man. We don't know the health status of JC Jackson. I mean, Keenan Allen may be coming back. Their center also coming back, but they do lose Rashawn Slater for the season. But they have to, hopefully they gain some of their bodies back to counteract the losses, because that injury list is just not looking good. Meanwhile, for the Texans, I mean, sure, you don't really have much options right now in terms of who you've got, but Davis Mills, he's got to make what's due because he's really not helping himself right now. So I am going out on a limb by picking the Clippers to win this game, but don't be surprised if the Houston Texans find a way to once again upend the Clippers once again. In a critical AFC South division matchup, the Tennessee Titans take on the Indianapolis Colts. The Titans last week, you know, they finally got back to their roots. I mean, at least in the most of the game. They fed Derrick Henry, but they still couldn't find a way to close out the game. And they had to once again hold on to beat the Las Vegas Raiders in a close game. Meanwhile, for Matt Ryan and the Colts, they got a last-second upset win over Patrick Mahomes and the Chiefs in a tightly knit game. So, of course, Ryan Tannehill and the offense, you know, they look a little bit better with Derrick Henry more involved. I mean, granted, it was the Chiefs' miscues that led them to that victory, but still. I mean, oh, sorry, that was for the Colts, but you get my point. For the thing with the Titans, I'm getting in my head with myself, by the way. The thing with the Titans, though, they got to learn how to close out these games. Sure, they get aggressive in the first half, but they take their foot off the gas pedal. So they got to keep striking in the second half, and their defense cannot let up. Meanwhile, for the Colts, I mean, yes, they did take advantage of the Chiefs' special teams miscues. But, of course, like Matt Ryan and that offense, you know, they did what they did. In that game, and they could be potentially getting back one key piece on their defense, and that's Shaquille Leonard, the linebacker, after missing the last two games with the back injury. So I'm going with the Indianapolis Colts in this game, and we'll see what happens from there. The Chicago Bears traveled to the Meadowlands to take on the Giants. You know, it was a showcase of Bears football last week as the Bears outlasted the Texans, while the Giants... Yeah, it's back to reality for them, for Danny Pennies and company, as they lost to the Dallas Cowboys. So, for the Bears, why aren't you letting Justin Fields throw? I mean, sure, Justin Fields did very bad against the Houston Texans, but let the man throw. Why are you limiting this offense to just, like, working on Justin Fields' handoff game? Like, man, come on. Meanwhile, for the New York Giants... I mean, sure, we have the return to Danny Pennies, but the offensive line is kind of doing him no favors. So I'm giving him a slight edge to the New York Giants here. But, I mean, that defensive line led by Roquan Smith of the Bears could make things interesting for this, what could be another showcase of Bears football. And then another interesting matchup of... on Sunday morning is the Jacksonville Jaguars. Yes, the all elite Jacksonville Jaguars, or maybe we could call them the Jacksonville Jaguars, sponsored by All Elite Wrestling, taking on the Philadelphia Eagles. So the Jacksonville Jaguars, sponsored by AEW, you know, they took advantage of an injury riddled Clippers team. Trevor Lawrence looked very good in that game. So did James Robinson and Travis Etienne and the rest of the offense. In the defense led by Josh Allen, the linebacker Josh Allen, not the quarterback, they looked pretty good. And let's not forget about Trayvon Walker as well, and a beatdown of the Clippers. Meanwhile, the Philadelphia Eagles just looked just as good against the Washington Commanders, as you got a great balanced performance from Jalen Hurts and his trio of Devontae Smith and A.J. Brown. And on the defensive side, they dominated Carson Wentz. So this is going to be a big test for these two teams. And I'm going to say it's going to be a close one that the Philadelphia Eagles win. Just because they have a more balanced team on the defensive end that can make things a little bit more difficult for Trevor Lawrence. The New York Jets traveled to take on the Pittsburgh Steelers. The Jets, you know, they did okay for what they had. I mean, sure, they got the crap Joe Flacco back, but they just couldn't finish drives. And that's what limited them to just field goals in a loss to the Cincinnati Bengals. While the Steelers looked one-dimensional, made too many mistakes, and the world was reminded of the MVP, the Nickelodeon valuable player, Mitch Trubisky. And that allowed the Browns to break it open in that week three opening loss, only on Amazon Prime Video, by the way. So, good news for the Jets is that they could possibly be getting Zach Wilson, their starter, back, if he's healthy enough, and if it'll make a difference for that Jets offense. But we'll see. This is a different Steelers defense that he's going to be facing without TJ Watt on his back. But let's see if that makes a difference. Meanwhile, Mike Tomlin, if this game, if he somehow loses to the New York Jets, a rebuilding New York Jets team, if this somehow does not convince him to start Kenny Pickett over the MVP, Mitch Trubisky, I don't know what to tell him. Like, I don't know what these filthy casual armchair quarterbacks have to tell him. I'm just saying, like, what more convincing does Mike Tomlin need to start Kenny Pickett over Mitch Trubisky? What is it? So I'm going on a limb here and saying that these young Lions in the New York Jets pull off the upset over the Steelers. Going to the afternoon slate of games, the Arizona Cardinals take on the Carolina Panthers. Arizona, contained by that Rams defense, and Kyler Murray did not look great. The Cardinals, again, struggled on offense in the first half, and those struggles carried over to the second half in a bad loss to their NFC West rivals. Well, the Panthers, they had a field day on defense, hammering Jameis Winston en route to a 22-14 win over the Saints. Cliff Kingsbury, it's been like, 3 weeks? He's got to find a way to get his offense to a much faster start in the first half. Like, it's, for whatever reason, it's just, they always start slow. And so it's like, I thought this happened in the second half of the season, but that somehow has translated over to the beginning of the season. And I get it. DeAndre Hopkins is not there, but you got to utilize what you have, but it's not happening. Meanwhile, for the Carolina Panthers, I think you would like to have more. You like to get out of more out of Baker Mayfield. And I think these like closely knit wins, these second wins, you know, they're kind of like saving Matt Rule's ass right now. So while I do pick the Carolina Panthers to win this game because their defense is saving his ass right now, I mean, you can somewhat expect the Arizona Cardinals to pull a magic trick out of their ass. The New England Patriots take on the Green Bay Packers. And I don't know, why is this game getting the national spotlight? Especially considering what happened last week to the Patriots, I kind of feel bad for them. So the Patriots, you know, they're able to keep it close for much of the game, but, you know, they ran out of steam in a loss to the Ravens. But a bigger loss for them was Mac Jones, their starter, to a multi-week ankle injury, and could possibly be even worse, depending on what the second option is for them. Meanwhile, for the Packers, they limited the Patriots' old quarterback and current Bucks quarterback, Tom Brady, and their in his offense in check, albeit without his full complement of weapons. And they managed to survive a last-minute rally from the Bucks to win out 14-12. So, of course, the biggest storyline for the Patriots is that offense without Mac Jones, and in comes in the veteran backup, Brian Hoyer. So, I mean, let's see what this offense looks like before we can, really judge them, before the game. But this is an opportunistic matchup for Aaron Rodgers and the Packers. I mean, it doesn't really affect them in the NFC standings, but to win this game against what could be a pushover opponent, man, they can take what they can get, right? So, obviously, go with the Packers in this one. The Denver Broncos take on the Raiders in an AFC West showdown sorts. And I say that lightly. The Broncos, you know, and they went toe-to-toe in one of the ugliest football games against the 49ers to date. But, you know, they did enough to get their first win in primetime over the 49ers, 11-10. Meanwhile, the Raiders, They rallied back from early turnovers and penalties in the fourth quarter until they just couldn't finish the comeback. And now they're the only winless team in the NFL as they lost to the Titans in week three. So, of course, for the Raiders, you got to win this game. You got to keep your season alive. You have this solid, talented core on offense with Derek Carr, Darren Waller, Hunter Renfrow, Davante Adams. The only thing that you don't have is an offensive line and maybe even a coach. Josh McDaniels has been stinking it up for the first 3 weeks. He has to find a way to get them together, put a better game plan together, find a way to get Davante Adams more involved early, find a way to get the offensive line, even with, if it's crappy right now, find a way to get them like integrated, protect Derek Carr more. You just got to find a way. Meanwhile, for the Denver Broncos, maybe this could be the wake-up call for Russell Wilson in the offense after, what, 3 straight weeks up to this point. They've been playing ugly, but maybe this game, this could be an opportunity for them to finally unleash their potential on offense. I mean, we know what their defense is capable of, but the offense, with Russell Wilson under center, with Melvin Gordon, Javonte Williams, Cortland Sutton, and Jerry Jeudy on the receiving end, this offense has potential to do something. They just need Nathaniel Hackett to unleash it. Come on, man. So I'm picking Denver to win this game, but this has to be a game that gives them the potential to unleash the offense. Then in the Sunday night football game, the Kansas City Chiefs take on the Tampa Bay Bucks. It was recently confirmed that this game is staying in Florida despite the latest hurricane, Hurricane Ian. So, I mean, hopefully everyone will stay okay if that hurricane does impact the area. So, hopefully everyone will be all right. So, for the Kansas City Chiefs, they lost their game to the Colts because of special teams issues and Patrick Mahomes not really having the greatest game in a while. And for Tom Brady, he also struggled without his full complement of receivers and a couple pieces missing on his O-line in a 14-12 defensive battle against the Packers that he lost. So both teams are looking to bounce back from ugly losses. I'm going to say the Chiefs are given the edge to bounce back over the Bucks in this one. Then in the Monday Night Football game to close out week one, what better way to do it than have the LA Rams take on my San Francisco 49ers in some good old-fashioned 49ers football. Oh, yeah. Oh, that's salivating 49ers football. Just think of it. If you didn't get enough of it last week in primetime Sunday night, now you get it in good old Monday night with good old Joe Buck and Troy Aikman. Oh, man, that's salivating Monday night football in primetime 49ers football. So, for the Rams, I mean, they rattled Kyler Murray and the Cardinals offense, limiting them to just field goals in their win. And you got to see their role players, their reserves, play a bigger role in that game. And, of course, for my 49ers, their defensive effort, a good one, by the way, yeah, that got wasted by an embarrassing offense shown off to all the world to see in that 11-10 loss to the Denver Broncos. So, of course, this is their first meeting since the 2021 NFC title game back in January. And I'm going to go on a limb here. I know the Niners faithful will hate me for this, but I'm just being honest here. The Rams are going to win this game. Straight up. The Rams defense is going to take advantage of that severely weakened offensive line now that Trent Williams is missing. And sure, Daniel Brunskill is back. But Aaron Donald's going to feast. He is going to feast on this offensive line. And what's Jimmy Garbage Fail going to do? He's going to happy feet his way into a sack or maybe into an interception. And sure, you could say, oh, we had his regular season history against the LA Rams. But this offense looks weak. This offense looks lost. Kyle Shanahan looks lost. I mean, I know I'm doubting them, but I kind of have a right to. But yeah, I'm going with the Rams in this one. I am. So those are my picks for week 4 of the 2022 NFL season. Let me know if I'm right. I probably am at this point. Or let me know if I'm wrong as well. Or let me know if you don't feel anything about these picks in the comments below. But anyway, this is Dylan Lasagna signing out of Very Cold Lasagna. And as always, keep that lasagna very cold in the fridge with your take on the world of pro wrestling and sports. And until next time, peace out.